I could have asked you this beforehand, but I guess before we get started, is there any reason that I should like not be sitting a certain way? Meanwhile, I'm like all curled up on your couch.
No,
Okay, cool.
no, girl, no. No, that's exactly what I want.
All right, just making sure.
Literally, like, we just chilling.
Okay.
Like, we're having conversation.
Just want to make sure.
I got you, girl. No.
I figure you've done this a few times now, so you're like, oh, well, this is not gonna work, or you should do this.
Yeah,
This is
no,
okay,
but
cool.
here's the crazy thing. The only way you find out if it works is if you do it. And what I've been doing has been working, so I'm like,
Done.
let's just do it that way. That's fine.
It works.
Sure. Let's do it that way.
Great.
All right, you ready?
Don't get hip hop. No.
Hello, this is Yolanda Murphy, and welcome to this Exceptional Journey podcast, where you will find inspiration to live courageously through adversity, empowerment to live freely despite your past, and ignition to live boldly in your purpose, all by walking the survivor side of life.
Good people. What is up? It is your girl, Yolanda Murphy, back with another episode of this Exceptional Journey podcast. How you been? If this is your first time, welcome, welcome, welcome. Stick around for a little bit. You're going to be absolutely amazed by what we talk about today. If this is not your first time, girl, how you been? Or dude, how the kids? How y'all doing? Either way it goes, thank you so much for clicking over to my little corner of the podcast world and rocking with me just for a little while. Again, Yolanda. And as you can tell, I have someone who's absolutely amazing with me today. But before we get there, let me plug, as always, my social media, because you guys know I'm Forgetful Jones. Do you remember Forgetful Jones? Like,
no.
No?
And I'm in the same age range.
Yes.
So, no.
I don't, maybe I just
Should
made
I know?
Forgetful Jones up. It was from Sesame Street. But anyway.
Oh.
So, yeah.
Oh.
Forgetful Jones
yes.
with the cowboy hat?
Totally.
Yes.
But honestly, had no idea at first.
Really?
Talking about.
Oh, I'm aging
I'm on board
myself,
now. I'm on board.
Okay.
I gotcha.
Yes. So, social media. Social media. Facebook and Instagram, you can find me at This Exceptional Journey. And then Twitter is at TEJ Podcast. Across all platforms, guys, even hashtag me TEJ Podcast with questions, comments, suggestions. Your girl wants to hear and connect with you, so let me know what's up. But again, let's cut to the chase. You've already heard her speak. Neha is in the building. What's up, girl?
Hi.
So I have Neha here with me today. She's such an amazing person.
Thank you.
She's also a part of, if you haven't noticed the running theme, part of the Young Adult Cancer Support Group.
Yay.
Out of the Cancer Caring Center here in the auspicious Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Guys, we're telling stories all day. Like, if you haven't been able to tell, like, we're telling everybody's story, okay? But welcome. Thank you for being
Hi.
On.
Thanks for having me. Yeah. Just, I'm so excited to be here.
I know. So, I mean, we're going to get to where she lives now, but she's from Pittsburgh. But she's here on holiday, and she decided to just record with me, guys. Isn't that amazing?
I didn't want to miss out.
Girl, I needed to tell your story. I wasn't playing games, so... Neha's here in the building. So, I mean, we're going to cut right to the chase. So the very first thing we're going to talk about is your story. So, I mean, tell us your story. Tell us, you know, how we got to this place together.
Okay.
Loaded
well,
question, I know.
I know, right? Here we go. I'm like, where exactly do you want me to start? I mean, pretty much the cancer story sort of started, which is how we clearly connected. I was 36. Had
so
yes had just left so I was working I had just left work. To be honest, the short version of the story is that I thought I was going to be abroad for probably the next 6 months or so. I had spent some time volunteering abroad a couple years prior. I was looking at some things there and had some other opportunities that I wanted to then follow up on, so I thought that's what I was doing. So I left work in March of 2016. I did a little bit of travel, and then was going to take this longer trip. So anyway, I was on one of my trips. I was in Nicaragua, and the way I remember the story is that I was about to put on some sunblock. I was going to change, and I felt this lump on the right side of my, on my right breast, on the outside of my right breast. And I thought, oh, that doesn't, something's wrong. And so, I don't know, fast forward, I came back from that. Just one thing after the other. I had it checked out. That immediately turned into, just a series of questions. And every time they'd get to, does it hurt, I would say no. And it just sort of seemed like there was this pause. Mm. And I have no idea, really. But maybe that was telling. I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. But it was always sort of like, okay, the next thing has to happen. So one thing led to another. And then I was diagnosed a couple weeks later with invasive ductal carcinoma, late stage 2B. It was in my lymph nodes as well. And I don't know, I feel like, right, life just sort of totally took a left turn and there we were. But I will say the one piece of it that, right, I wasn't in a lot of pain. Had I gotten on the plane and gone halfway around the world to volunteer for 6 months, I honestly think I would have put it off for an extended period of time because I felt fine. Mm-hmm. And who knows where I'd be today or what would have happened. So I am thankful for that. Outside of that, I immediately, right, that was the middle of May that I was diagnosed. And
in 2016, right?
2016.
Okay. I didn't know we were diagnosed in the same year. Yes. That is so crazy.
Yes. I think relatively similar stories from what I remember, but you had chemo first or surgery first?
Surgery.
So I immediately, right, I got diagnosed and then started chemo. So I did the 6 months of chemo. Okay. And then decided that I wanted to do the least amount of surgery possible. Mm. I wasn't genetically positive. And so I think had that been the case, it would have been a different story.
Yeah.
But I wasn't. And so for me, it was less is more, and I'm going to do the least amount possible. So I had a lumpectomy, had a re-excision, actually, which was, that was a hard time. Like, to go through chemo, have a surgery, and then realize, crap, they didn't get it all.
Oh.
I, then had to decide, was I going to now go in to try again, or was I now going to make the decision to have a mastectomy? But I went in for the re-excision. That was successful. And then I did the 6 weeks of radiation. So treatment ended essentially almost exactly a year later. I think I was 2 weeks short of a year.
Okay.
So I ended treatment in May of 2017. And then it's been a crazy year and a half since then, I guess. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it feels like it's been that long, and sometimes it doesn't feel like it's been that long at all.
Oh, I can attest to that.
So, yeah, that's sort of that story. And I'd say it was probably partway through chemo that I found the Cancer Caring Center and the Young Adults Group. And that has been absolutely amazing. I feel like it's been, right, I'm lucky enough to have a lot of really close friends in Pittsburgh, and I have a lot of family that's been amazing. And there have definitely been people around throughout the whole process, treatment and everything else that I've needed. And I'm super, super grateful for all of that. But honestly, there's just, when you need a space where people get it, that group has been amazing. Mm-hmm. And I truly feel like, you know, we've been able to share highs and lows together.
Absolutely.
And it's been a really big deal. So anyway, that is where I found you, and
yes, girl,
how we're here today.
yes. I think it's so crucial. And the running thing really with I won't say everyone, but majority of other members of the group have really been the saving grace is the group. And not necessarily because there's hundreds or thousands of us, but you have a couple people who are like, yo, I get it. I understand exactly. And I don't have to explain. Don't have to tell you why I'm tired. I don't have to tell you why I'm freaking tearing my hair out because I have scans in a couple days. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
You just get it. And you're like, holy cow.
Or just
write
the highs and the lows and the emotions. Yep. And I mean, the reality is we're all trying to be super positive and upbeat and trying to get to the next day and all those things. But you have your moments. And
absolutely.
You're trying to take care of everyone around you, but you also need to be just taking care of yourself. And
right.
I do. There's something that's been really, really amazing about just being able to be as real as you need to be at the group.
And raw as you need to be. Because everyone understands,
for
right?
sure.
Cool. So you said you had your genetics tested, right?
I did.
And those came back negative.
Correct.
Or that there were no mutations or anything
Correct.
Like that. Did you have any family history of cancer?
No. So, I mean, both my parents, big families. I did have an aunt that had breast cancer in her 60s. She passed shortly after, but not from the cancer itself. And, but that being said, there's so many people in the family that even when I talk to the genetics team prior, they're like, that's likely not enough for us to say, oh, that's probably what it is. Okay. But again, based on my age, they were like, well, we should still run it and just see, but not genetically positive.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here was my thing. When I was diagnosed, because I was adopted, I don't know if you knew that.
Yes, yep.
So I don't have family history. So every time someone asks, they're like, family history. I'm like,
I don't know.
IDK, IDK. I'm just going to put IDK, like I'm going to make a sign that says family history IDK, like just flat out. But anyway, I say that to say, so my surgical oncologist was like, yeah, let's go ahead and get the genetics done because you don't know your medical history or family history. We definitely need it. And then she was like, if there's extra things they can test, you might as well just test everything because you never know.
Got it.
You know what I mean? Like genetically wise, like what you're carrying or you know what I mean? So I had all the panels done, honey. Okay. When I tell you all the panels, but they all came back good. You know what I mean? It wasn't like I wasn't carrying any genes for anything. Okay. So, but it was a good thing. To be tested, you know what I mean? Just to be on the safe side.
Absolutely.
You think?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think, right. If nothing else, I mean, all overwhelming, but I feel like it just gives you a little more information as you're about to like jump into learning way more than you ever wanted to know about breast cancer and trying to make all the decisions that you then are going to need to make. Because as we've all learned, every story is different. Mm-hmm. And while we can all get it, I feel like, right, there's not a clear answer. What I really wanted was for someone to say, okay, so now this is exactly what you have to do.
Cut and dry, right.
That's so not how it went.
Not at all. Not at all. And because all of our bodies are so different. I was just having this conversation with myself about my body or about our bodies and how, although we see them as imperfect, but God made them so perfectly that if we pay attention to them, like they tell us everything we need to know. Like legit. Like it's so crazy. I was just telling Neha, because this is, I mean, as you're listening, it'll probably be maybe in January I'll post this, but it's for us, it's the day after Christmas. And I was just telling her I had a really fun filled holiday weekend with friends and family and food and drinks, and my body is feeling it. Like it's Wednesday and I'm like dragging. Like I'm not a spring chicken, but even when I was, like the amount of consumption of food. And here's the thing, I usually eat really, really well during the week. At least try to, like baked chicken and salads. But girlfriend, these past couple days, I was eating everything fried and dipped in something, okay?
You know,
and the drinks were overflowing. Right, and that's every house I went to, everyone was like, here, it's holiday time, enjoy yourself. So I'm like, hell yeah. But at the end of the day, I like was sitting up today as I was stirred because it's 1 o'clock and I'm not off the bed yet. And my body's like, oh my gosh, what did we just do the last couple of days? But it's just amazing. And you know, to tie it back in with the cancer, I mean, like you said, you felt fine. You know what I mean? And I did too.
Absolutely.
Like I legitimately, I mean, I was moving into my new place. Like it, I was on a high.
I just left work because I thought I was going to be traveling the world for X amount of time. Like I totally get it.
Yeah. But my body was like, no, girlfriend.
No.
So it was so crazy. I was, you know, I'm still recouping as we sip on our glasses of red wine.
Yeah, whoops.
The wine helps. It's great. It ties in perfectly with the rest of the weekend, right? So, okay, so we've talked about your journey. So as of right now, like, you're good. No evidence of disease. Had a
mammogram this morning and knock on wood, thank God, all the things. Yes, currently no evidence of disease and banking on it staying that way for a long time.
So do you go every year?
Do you have your
scans every year?
Yes. Okay. Right. And I think all of that is super challenging too. I was just talking to somebody about that, which, right, again, everyone's follow-up is so different. And I've had to like try and find my peace with, okay, I'm not going to panic because, well, someone else has these three tests done and I only have this one done.
Oh my gosh. I thought I was the only one.
Crazy. It makes me crazy because it's like, well, why am I not doing that? Or should I be doing that?
Right.
Or, you know, whatever. But I think I've just tried to find my peace with, it's not like I'm not asking the questions and I'm not trying to talk about it, but this is where we've landed. So I'm trying to get on board with That's what it is. But I do feel like, right, there's some buildup and anxiety going into them for a handful of different reasons. And I'm sure that'll be the case every time that happens. But it was good to get a result. And honestly, mm-hmm. hopefully that'll keep me kind of just moving forward.
Yeah.
Until the next time I need to check for one reason or the other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just had mine done. What is this? This is end of December. Because I was having breast pain.
Gotta love that.
Girl. So I was like, oh, no, we're not going to play around with this.
Really?
Had one done maybe 2 to 3 weeks ago.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe 2-3 weeks ago.
Okay.
And girlfriend, I was in there. Like, I have some calcification
okay.
around my scar. Because I also had a lumpectomy, of course.
Yep, yep.
So I saw people coming and going. Like, people were coming in that came after me but were leaving before me.
Right, and you're like, oh, my God, what's happening?
Like, when I tell you, by the time I left the doctor's office, I was physically exhausted because mentally my brain, like,
you talked yourself
about,
in and out of 17 scenarios.
Yes. And then she had, oh, Yolanda, come with me. We need more images. I was like, oh, you know, the radiologist looked at these. She wants to make sure by your scar, you know, the calcification is what it is, whatever, whatever. So she brings out this gigantic plate, like, for magnification. And you already know when they squeeze, tuck, and lift, don't breathe. Turn your head to the right. Hold right here. I was so over it. When I tell you, I was so over it. And then, oh, go back and wait in the waiting room.
Oh, yeah.
A sea of pink and white robes. And you keep telling me to go back in this goddamn waiting room. Girlfriend.
And just deep breaths. deep breaths until
I tried
you
to
know
stay on my phone the whole time.
React, yeah. Yep.
Like, to keep my mind off of things, I was trying to, like, scroll through Instagram, trying to look up funny videos. I took out my Bluetooth earbuds, was watching videos. Like, I was there for 2 hours.
And it's, yeah, I get it. And then, right, like, it's just, like you're saying, you have this new pain, you go in. I just think that's the thing. It's been the case ever since. I mean, post my surgery, I had a lot of, when they took the lymph nodes, cut through the nerves, I had a lot of nerve pain, right? They just couldn't, every time something would change, I'd freak out and be like, oh my God, is it back? What's happening? Yep. And even now, it's the same thing, right? I know that, like, I should be calmer about it.
No.
But it's the same thing. Like, a week ago, I had this crazy hive on my right arm. I don't know where it came from. It wasn't itchy. All of a sudden, I noticed it. It was massive. I had had a little bit of a fever the day before, which I honestly equated to I'd been traveling the week prior. I was running on no sleep.
Again,
I can't keep up the way I used to. So I really just thought, oh, well, it's my body telling me I need to, like, rest, right? Mm-hmm. Then all of a sudden, the next day, I see this, like, massive hive, and I'm like, oh, my God, I'm missing some lymph nodes in that arm. It could be an infection.
Yep.
Is that related to, like, right? Everything ties back to cancer. And I'm like,
no,
oh,
literally.
My God, is that what happened?
Oh, I just hit my toe off the couch. Dang it, it's the cancer.
It's out of control.
It's because I had breast cancer.
It's shown up in
my God.
This ridiculous format, right? Which, I mean, who knows? Like, yes, you want to be aware, but I don't want to be crazy.
Like, hyper-vigilant. Like, so, it's back. Just check everywhere.
I have a sister who's a pediatric oncologist. And I, you know, so of course I call her and I'm like, should I be freaking out? Should I whatever? And this, that. And she's like, okay, well, here's the thing. It's still, I mean, you had a little bit of fever yesterday. It could be an infection. It is on your right arm. She goes, it isn't, I'm going to bank on it's not anywhere, anything related to the cancer. Like, get it checked out.
Yeah.
Like, you know, get some antibiotics for that. But she's like, just breathe. Like, it's okay. So, right, I mean, just those, I guess what I'm saying is I'm imagining you in the waiting room and I can totally relate because you've just run through all these scenarios.
Yes. Like 12,000.
And why? Why is it taking an extra 5 minutes than it did last time?
Girl, I was already putting myself in the grave. I was like, when I die, I want a rose gold casket with plush blanket and pillow on the inside.
Why was I worried about tomorrow?
Right. Why was I when I'm getting bad scans today? Like, what in the world? So I can go,
Yay.
So, I mean, everything came back good, though.
Everything came back good.
So I will also be scanned again in a year. But it's just,
Yes.
It's something you really can't explain to someone that's never been through it.
Because I just think that you want to understand. I mean, I'd like to think that I would have been as open as I could have been trying to understand prior. And then it's not until you're in it that you're just like, I was saying to you earlier that I truly think that there's something to be said about I mean, unless you have a reason that you've thought about it, but for me, prior to the breast cancer diagnosis, I truly believed I had this infinite amount of time.
Yep.
I was just going to keep doing all things I'm going to do. And sometimes I would panic about, like, oh, my God, but I want this to happen now. But it wasn't because I thought I wasn't going to be here tomorrow. It's because I literally was like, there are so many things I want to do. I don't want to waste my time. Right. I feel like I was trying to make the most of every minute. I truly believe that I was trying to live experiences. Mm-hmm. Right. I just want to do. Yeah. I always want to do an experience. And so I went from thinking I have this infinite amount of time, and then all of a sudden you get diagnosed and you start treatment, and one thing leads to another. And I know that it's different for everybody, but like, I feel like every side effect you can think of through chemo, like, was my life. Mm-hmm. And any one of those things on its own is okay. But when they all pile up, I mean, you just sort of feel like this broken person, and you're trying to figure out if trying to stay positive, trying to get through it, trying to get to the next day, trying to whatever. But all of a sudden, you're focused on today, right? I've got to get through today, or this part of treatment, or, you know, everything else just sort of becomes on hold. And then you get through it all, and thank God, I mean, not everyone's in that boat, but, you know, I was told that there's no evidence of disease, and I'm now supposed to just go back to living my life.
Regular, you know.
I feel nothing like I used to. I've gained all this weight. I, like, look totally different. My arm hurts. I've got this nerve pain, right? Like, all these things, and you're like,
oh, no, go ahead.
No big deal. Yeah, just go back to it. Yeah. And so I think, and right, you also start to look better. Like, I didn't, quote unquote, look as sick. Yep. And I think people mean well, right? Yeah. Nobody wants to see you in pain and whatnot. But I just think, right, some of that support sort of falls away. And not because of anything other than people just assume that you're good. Mm-hmm. And anyway, all to say that, right, you go through all these things and you're just supposed to go back to believing you have all this time again. And on one hand, I don't want to think about not having it.
Right.
And on the other, it's really hard to not all of a sudden put so many more expectations on what I'm doing. Right. Like, I think you're supposed to be more graceful with yourself and, like, give yourself a little bit of grace and, like, just be. And instead, I almost feel like I'm even worse because I'm like, oh, I've got all this stuff that I want to do with my time. And, like, what am I doing? Am I actually doing those things?
Right.
You know, what if I don't have that kind of time? And I don't know. I think sometimes it makes me a little crazy.
No, it makes me stir crazy all the time. My dad is so funny. We were having a conversation because my mom caters, and she was catering this you know, really important event recently. And she was naming some of the stuff that she was making and saying, oh, you know, I think she'll like this. And my dad said they were talking about me, like, oh, you know, she would like this and she would eat this or whatever. And then my dad said in their conversation, he said to my mom, he said, I feel like cancer gave her energy. And I was like, what? He said, because I feel like now after your diagnosis, I feel like you're doing so much more and you're always on the move and you're always on the go and you're always doing something. He said, you were busy before. Like, I've always been a busy person. He said, but I feel like, you know, now cancer gave you energy. And I was like, so my dad's not the best linguistic person. He's not really, you know,
totally.
What dad is, you know.
Totally.
But what I took from that, essentially what we're discussing is we don't know how much time we have. We don't, I mean, we all know that we can die at any moment, cancer or not.
Sure.
But after you're diagnosed at a young age, it's a completely different mindset. It is a completely different viewpoint from this side of cancer. I always tell my friends ABC and BBC, after and before breast cancer.
Totally.
Because I'm not the same person.
No.
And, you know, that to me, like what my dad said was the truth. Like, I wouldn't necessarily say cancer gave me energy, but it gave me determination to live my best life with whatever time I have left. And if that means me doing hustle and bustle, if that means me recording 6 podcasts in 1 week,
then I'm going to do it.
I'm going to do it.
You know, I have to say that I think that's amazing. And that's almost where I struggled because I don't know, maybe I wasn't, but in my mind, I was living at that pace prior.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know, and not to say it's a bad thing at all. I think it's amazing. I think there's so many people that go through something like this and then say, hey, it sort of woke me up. Like, now I'm going to do all these things I want to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think my struggle from day one has sort of been, I felt like I was living at that pace anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying to do, you know, some of these things that were off the beaten path. But for me, because that's what I wanted to do with my life, and I was living at that pace.
Mm-hmm.
And I have always been, you know, sort of the same. High energy, I'm going to do, like, there's a lot of things on the list. I didn't need a lot of sleep. Like, it just is the way I functioned.
Girl. I barely slept.
Oh, like, totally.
I would get 4 hours and be like, all right, let's go.
Oh, my God. My friends now, who I'm sure will listen to this at some point, joke around because they're like, welcome to the mortal world. Like, you have now reached our level. I'm like, that's super sweet. But this whole sleep thing, like, why do I need that? It's taking up a lot of time.
I mean, I could be doing something else. What?
So I feel like I was living at that pace. Cancer just put me at a hard stop.
Yeah.
And right, in some weird way, I think we all try and find justifications for all the crap that we go through mm-hmm. and life that happens. And so I'm still trying to figure out, like, what was that supposed to do?
Yeah.
And right, like, even today, things are fine, but I know that there's something else. And mm-hmm. so if nothing else, in the moment, I'm trying to be better about being present mm-hmm. and realizing that there are these things that I want to do. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not doing them right this moment, maybe I just need to, like, also, don't give up on doing them.
Right.
But right. I almost feel like I've been putting extra pressure on myself. Like, you just went through all this, and now you should be doing those things. Why are you doing these other things? Mm-hmm. And so I'm trying to remind myself to be in the moment, make the most of what my day-to-day is right now.
Yeah.
Enjoy that experience, mm-hmm. and then still try and get to wherever I'm going. Yeah. And, you know, that might not all be clear today. I want it to be. I want it to be like, oh, crap, this happened, and now this is exactly what I want. But right. That's so not how it's gone.
Yeah.
And so I think I'm trying really hard to be, you know, in that mindset of make the most of the scenario today mm-hmm. and then figure out what you're working towards.
Yeah.
And just keep reminding myself that I can still get there. Yeah. And I'm trying to also reframe sort of my past as well, in that, again, everyone's story is different. But mm-hmm. for me, while I was going through treatment, right, and you are having these crazy thoughts of what if I don't have more time or what if I don't get there, I was pretty okay with what I had done prior, right? Mm-hmm. Like, there's always more that I want to do, but I felt good about some of the choices that I had made, and mm-hmm. I truly believe that helped me get through treatment.
Good.
And I'm trying to stay really focused on that's the way I lived my life, and that's the way I should continue trying to live it. So it might not all feel perfect, but that's all to say that I feel like you go through this stuff, and instead of it being easier to just do your day-to-day after, mm-hmm. I almost feel like we, and I don't know if this is true for everyone, but I almost feel like we put more pressure on ourselves to make sure we're doing whatever we can be.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Listen, so I was praying the other day, and you know, me and my Father God, we talk all the time. And I literally, like, the way I equate it verbally, like, this is how I was praying. And I said, okay, this is where I am. I know today is today. I can only do today what I can do today. I have 24 hours, well, 12, you know, depending upon how long I sleep. I have X amount of hours today to do what I need to do today. Be present, be in the moment, because sometimes I think so far ahead, like, I want to get this done. I want to get this accomplished. So be here today, be present, be in tomorrow, because yes, I want to be able to get stuff done tomorrow. Be in 3 to 6 months, what you want to see, work towards that, or at least work backwards from it. But it's difficult, at least for me sometimes, because it's this weird juggling act. It's this, like, just weird, like, not rat race, it's not like hamster in a wheel. It's this, like, constant, oh, let me be in today, let me be in today, and oh, wait, let me think about tomorrow. Oh, well, let me think about, because, you know what I mean? Because, first of all, my mind is always going, like, literally, 24/7, like, even when I'm trying to sleep, my mind is going, like, it's ridiculous. And I'm grateful, don't get me wrong, because, I mean, I'd rather have it going than have no drive
not going.
Desire.
Yeah, totally.
Right. But it's just, I don't know. I get it. I mean.
It's finding that balance of, like, being aware and wanting to do and be and achieve and, you know, I don't know, embrace it all. And at the same time, not make yourself totally crazy.
Yeah.
Because, oh my God, there might be this pressure of
yeah.
this potential limited time. And how do I make it all work perfectly today? Right. I don't know. Maybe we were putting that pressure on ourselves anyway, but in my mind,
probably,
it feels a little more extreme.
Yeah,
now.
Because we feel like we have less time.
Yeah, which is just annoying because...
So annoying.
I want to believe that I'm living the best way I can be
living
every day.
Living my best life.
Anyway.
Yeah, it's...
I don't know.
It's. I mean, because here's the other thing we have to remember. We're still in our 30s. I mean, we will be 40 soon. Not telling any ages.
soon.
Not telling any ages.
We're having some big parties. I'm just saying.
We're just saying. You're invited. That's all we're saying.
It's going to be a full year of partying.
Listen, you're invited. But we're still in our 30s, though.
Yeah.
And that's the other kicker, because when I talk to my friends and family, like, of course, you know, I'm not going to say I downplay what I feel, but sometimes to me, it's like you're talking to a brick wall, not necessarily because they're not listening, but they won't get it. So there are some times where I'm like, I'm not 40, and here I am having to have, or had to almost face my immortality, having to face death, you know what I mean? Like, to me, it was 50-50. I tell people all the time, like, I could have lived, I could have died. Because
absolutely.
I know people who did.
Because you just don't
you
know.
You don't know.
And everyone's story is different. And then you hear so much of that, you know, right? I think everyone wants to relate, and nobody means it out of bad intention.
Yeah.
But it's sort of like this person that made it, or this person that didn't make it, or this person, whatever. And I think as we've all come to learn, like, it really is. It just, it depends on the story. It depends on each person. And, you know, I don't know. I can't imagine now not knowing all the people that I know through this past couple years.
Yep.
But at the end of the day, for every good story you hear, there's also really, really hard, tragic stories. And
well, we know about that. I mean, this year was insane.
It's insane.
Like, how many people, like, in our group and with YSC?
Absolutely.
Like, freaking ridiculous.
It's heartbreaking, you know? And it's just, it's tragic in itself.
Mm-hmm.
It's scary and brings on this whole different level of fear.
Listen,
in our own stories.
Yes.
There are people that are living with it every day, and those of us that are trying to celebrate this no evidence disease, but at the same time, you hear the stats of recurrence.
Yep.
And, you know, it's hard. It's hard to manage the outside world, too. There's people that are, you know, understanding of that, but then there's just as many people that are like, well, you just have to think positive, and it's, you know, and that's that. And I'm like, don't get me wrong. My natural state is wanting to be positive.
Yeah, absolutely.
But
however,
there is the reality of all these things.
Let's
hear
face
the stats, the things that can happen, and you don't want to ignore that either. So, again, it's trying to find that balance of how do you manage that reality.
And do you ever learn to do it, really, though? Because I don't know about you, but to me, I feel like, I mean, February, it'll be 3 years since I was diagnosed. I had my surgery in March, started chemo in April, and, you know, yada, yada, yada. What I've found over the past 2.5, almost 3 years, is that every day is something new.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
It's a different, you're going through a different time.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah.
So how do you, like, can you think you can even find that balance since every day is a winding road? Like,
God, I mean, I can only hope that we get more and more graceful. I don't know because it wasn't any easier this year to hear about hard news than it was the year prior.
Right.
Maybe it hit different, you know, different, not nerves, but different emotions.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right. I mean, I don't know because I.
But isn't that interesting?
I can relate
about?
To what you're saying in that, right? Like, going through treatment, it was just going through treatment. And it was like trying to get through it. As soon as it ended, it was sort of like, oh my God, like, where's my life, right? Like, I woke up one morning, done with treatment, feeling totally different.
Mm-hmm.
Body feeling like a completely different person.
Mm-hmm.
Tired, exhausted, all the things, right, that you go through physically. And then on top of that, like, I mean, I was in a place where I had just left work to go halfway around the world. So I literally gave up the apartment, moved back home, and thank God I had a home to go to.
Mm-hmm.
And parents that are amazing and, you know, family and friends that, like, were super supportive. But I woke up one morning, I'm like, I'm out of work. I'm at home. I, you know, like, what am I doing? What's next? And I feel nothing like I used to.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. And so, right, it was that. And then you get through that. And then it's sort of like, well, okay, now what's next?
Yeah.
And honestly, fast forward a year. And the challenge today has really been this idea of, again, putting pressure on myself about, well, what do you want to do? And why aren't you doing that yet? And is this it?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you have all these priorities in your life. And I know you alluded to it before, but, you know, I made a move recently. And is that right? But again, I'm trying to come back to be in the moment, make the most of it, you know. And it's not that I'm not grateful for a million things, but I feel like from day one, I've also had a really hard time with, I am naturally really, I'd like to believe that I'm really aware and grateful for so many things and happy to have people in my life and the support and all these things, but that doesn't mean that I'm also not totally angry at the fact that this Absolutely. Is the world that we're in, right? And Absolutely. So how do those two emotions coexist? And right. how do you still continue onwards? And I don't know, maybe that that's also the juggling
act I'm talking about.
The challenge of being someone that is, you know, hyper aware. Like, not to like, say that I make the right choices all the time, but
still,
I think about these things all the time. Yeah. So I'm with you on my mind is always running. Oh my and gosh. I don't know. So I guess your question is a valid one. I mean, maybe in a handful of years, there's a whole different thing that I'm trying to like balance. Right. And then there's things I haven't even dealt with yet. Like Girl. You think about, right. Like the, which I'm certain so many people go through and right. The I'm still single and I, you know, the fertility piece and the, you know, it's just all the things.
Oh my gosh.
That aren't even on the radar yet because I'm still trying to manage today.
Because I'm still trying to manage today. I was just having this conversation with a friend about still being single and not being married. Well, being single and not married and then not having children. I was like, you know what? I'm trying to live for today, but like I'm still trying to live for a future. Yeah. Where does that come into play?
Right.
Oh, this juggling act.
You know what? Gosh. I was just talking to someone, like I know you just said that it's day after Christmas, and I was just talking to somebody about, you know, what are my words going to be for 2019?
Oh yeah.
Seems to be a running theme in this conversation. So maybe I need to start exploring the word balance.
Girl, listen. I was thinking of what I want my word to be for next year. I don't know.
I'm still working on it.
I thought I had it, but then I saw something else and I was like,
I know, right?
I think I want it to be that.
There's so many things. I'm going to go with three.
Okay.
And I haven't landed there yet. Okay. But stay tuned.
We'll give you the three words soon. Three would be good though. Three.
Three is a solid.
Yeah, because one can't really, you know.
No, I just think encompass. There's too many pieces of what we're all trying to work on. And maybe there is only one, but in my mind, I'm going to
go. No, but I think, I mean, there might be like one that's like overall, like growth. Cool. You can grow in every area of your life.
Sure.
But in specific areas, like you want certain.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I'm going to go with three.
We'll see. 2019 is Tuesday.
It's crazy. So what you're okay. saying is start thinking?
Right. It is Tuesday. Can you believe it?
No. And I have to say, was it like this for you? I feel like the year of treatment felt like it was 10 years. But I also, you were working through it all. I was not working through it all. I literally was watching, like I feel like I was watching the seconds on the clock. And it felt like that year was like 10 years long. But I have to say that the one part about post-treatment, the one part, there's probably many, but the one part that like feels like, oh, thank God, like it feels normal again. Mm-hmm. As much as I don't want time to disappear, mm-hmm. it's nice to know that time feels like it's moving just as crazy as it always has in the past again, right? Yeah. Like, I don't know where this year has gone.
Girl,
listen. It's crazy.
My treatment year, I feel like, and like you said, I feel like because I was so focused on surviving, that I was like, okay, what's next? Boom. Okay, let's. To me, my year flew past. To me.
Yeah, I felt like it was 10 years
old. But I will say after I was done, like I finished my last radiation treatment October 16. And.
Oh, that was. Okay.
Yeah. And excuse me. I like went into the new year not really. Like, how do I want to explain? I really didn't have any goals or dreams because I just wanted to live. Like, does that make sense? Like, I really didn't.
Yeah.
Because I just finished surviving. I was just trying to live. Like, isn't that crazy? Like,
it is, but maybe in some weird way, it's helpful to hear you say that. Because, right, again, I've been talking about putting so much pressure on myself for mm-hmm. having the answers. And maybe. And I did give myself time. I mean, I finished treatment in May of 2017. And. I mean, I took time off and I, you know, took time off of the time off that I had. I don't know. I mean, I spent some time abroad. I spent some time with family. I did finally get away again for a little bit. Not in the same capacity that I was originally planning on, but it did happen. And then I came back and was trying to sort it out. And the reality is it still took almost like a good year mm-hmm. plus to like figure out, you know, mm-hmm. where I was going for work. So, yeah, I don't know, but it's good to hear you say, like, you know, maybe that just all needed to be part of it, right? It was mm-hmm. just living.
Yeah.
I mean, don't know.
At least that was me, because here's the thing. I've never been someone that does like resolutions or anything like that, but I do every year try to do to be better. You know what I mean? Do something to better myself, whether it's personal development or, you know, spiritually, physically, you know what I mean? Working out or eating better, what have you. But I just remember the end of October. I mean, it was the beginning of October when I finished radiation, but literally from like October, maybe to February, maybe March-ish. Like I really didn't have a plan. I mean, I was working, of course, but I didn't have a plan because I just wanted to make sure I lived. And because I was in survivor mode, all of 16, literally from the end of January when I found my lump, diagnosed beginning of February until October, like literally every day was surviving. Babe, you got to survive today. You have to survive today. You have chemo today. You have to survive today. Like, don't think about a month from now. You have to survive today. But when I no longer had to survive today, I was like, okay, how are you going to live today? That was my thought process. Huh. So for months, I was like, okay, how are we going to live today? Like, what are we going to do different? Okay, you don't have to go to radiation every day now. So what are you going to do to live today? Do something different. There were some times in the spring, like maybe April, May, I would just go to the park. Now, granted, I don't like outdoors. I hate bugs. I was a Girl Scout growing up. I was a brownie.
You crack me up.
Hate outdoors. I like cookouts. I like playing like kickball outside. But camping, like cancer camp, I was so glad we were in the cabin. I was like, are we staying in a tent, Stephanie? I'm sorry. I can't go.
I mean, I'm with you. Here's the thing. I'm not into the bugs. But no. I do love being outside. Mm-mm. There's something.
I like being outside for the summer.
I mean, okay. All right. Fair enough. I mean, here's the thing. I definitely don't need to like be in a tent, and it's not that I can't.
You like hiking?
I love hiking.
Oh no.
But I'm not into the bugs. I do love hiking.
I can just look at the mountain. I don't need to hike it. I can take a picture from the bottom.
I have to tell you that I did spend a couple months after I was done with treatment. I spent some time in Montana, but I did while I was out there.
Who goes to Montana?
Exactly. Who goes to Montana? And I was like, I'm going to cross this off the list.
I ended up spending
a week in Glacier National Park. And
it was
amazing. It was amazing.
See, that I would want to do something like that.
So that was amazing. I mean, again, don't need the bugs. So I hear you on some pieces. And then outside of that, there is something really beautiful about being in the out. I hear. Okay. So maybe you don't want to cross the street and just hang out in the park right across the street.
No.
But there was something amazing about those, like...
That sounds amazing, though.
The views and this...
Because that's an experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
But some people, like, just... I mean, I would go to the park. Like, I would be writing, you know, in my journal, watching the kids frolic. And then, like, after an hour, maybe hour and a half, I'm like, all right, time to go. Time to pack up the blanket. There's bugs. It's getting dark. People's letting their dogs all over the place. No, 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 no. It's time to go. But I say all of that to say I wanted to, you know, go into 17... different, but mentally I was just trying to, okay, what are we gonna do different today? Okay, let's live past what we just went through. It was difficult, but it was challenging, but it was worth it.
Yeah.
Say that all to say, going now into 19, I want to focus, like drill this podcast, man. Just like get it done. Like just get it. I have so many goals and dreams and visions I want to do.
That's amazing, though.
Wouldn't you agree, though? I mean, even you, like, so let's just tie this in right here. This is another question I was going to ask. So what are you doing now? Like, and I say that to say, because now going into 19, are your dreams or goals or visions different now that you're in a different physical location?
I think I'm still figuring that out.
Okay.
So in terms of, you know, work, like I needed to get back on my feet. I needed to get back to it, right? I was in a scenario where I was out of work. I think the change of pace just, right, it's creating a lot of thought. I'm trying to figure out what's next. You had an interesting conversation with somebody just the other day and, you know, sort of talking about that idea of like, even just outside of the cancer world and just when you're normally looking for a new gig and people are asking about like 5 years down the road. And he was sort of saying,
hey, you know, I when I've been answering that question recently, I've been answering it in a way where it's just like life is changing all the time. Yep. The world around us is changing. The environment is changing. We're changing. And so he's like, I've started to give people, he's like, as I get older, I'm less afraid to give people a very real answer that like, yeah. I don't know what that looks like just yet. I mean, I'm going to do the best that I can do.
Right.
And I want to do the best that I can do. And we'll see where I land. Right. And I think it's finding my peace with, which sometimes is easy and sometimes is not. I don't know. It's finding my peace with knowing that I might want a clear answer and I don't know what that totally is today. And I'm trying to like live in that space. So
yeah,
I'm sort of answering your question by just saying, you know, I think it's the move has pushed me to keep thinking about things. But none of that is totally clear yet. And I'm just trying to get back on my feet and figure out what's next.
Listen, but that's all you can do, though.
I don't know.
I want
better answers and clearer answers, and I want them yesterday, but that's not how that's worked. So.
But listen, here's the kicker. At the end of the day, that's okay.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because after, and here's the crazy thing to me. I think I kind of stumbled upon just thinking of some of my goals for next year, of course, including the podcast and my blog. I kind of stumbled upon this because I wanted my voice to be heard and I wanted our voices to be heard.
Yeah.
But to be honest, I've been thinking about this, well, podcasting specifically, since at least the summer of this year. But I started thinking about blogging the end of 17. Yeah, the end of 2017. But I had no idea what I was going to do.
Absolutely.
And that was okay.
Totally.
You know what I mean? So I say that to say from the end of 17 to the end of 18, yes, things have unfolded. Things have been unpacked. Things are getting accomplished. But I didn't know, like, going into it.
Well, I think it's super inspiring. So I'm so excited to hear you say that, only because I don't know, and we've talked about this before.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because I feel like, not cancer-related at all, but I've thought about so many of those things in terms of a lot of the travel I've done, the time I've spent abroad, stories that I have wanted to tell. I've never really been a big writer, but I've actually thought about writing because I'm like, I think there's stuff that I have to share with people.
Yeah.
And then fast forward, a friend started a podcast. And so, right, like I think even when you told me you were thinking about it, I'm like, oh my God, it's been on the radar more so jokingly than it was serious, I think, because I'm like, I love to talk and I can like ramble forever. So
if
I'm like,
you can't tell, we both love
like,
to talk.
Yeah, right. And I'm like, so, and it's not always like, you know, from point A to point B super clear. Sometimes I like to tell 15 stories in between.
Listen, if you've been listening to any of my previous podcasts, you can tell any conversation I have with someone. And to be honest, this is me in real life. Like, this is me.
Totally.
With my friends, like, all the time, we'll go off on small tangents and come right back. Like,
well, and sometimes I don't even remember where I started.
It's okay.
That's always really great.
That's the whole point of the conversation, though. That's what makes it so much fun.
I guess what I'm saying is that I feel like I've talked about a lot of these things, but, like, it's never been quite clear in what is that thing that's going to get me started or sort of push me there finally. And I'm still not sure that I'm completely certain, but all those things are on the radar. I guess what I'm saying is I really love that, like, you had thought about it and then just sort of ran with it.
Mm-hmm.
And, right, like, I feel like I generally have always been really into reading, learning, like, wanting to, sort of like you're saying, like, you want to, like, better yourself, right? Always into those things that are super motivating and how do I better myself and how do I whatever. And, right, in all of that, generally, one of the things that, like, comes up all the time is like, just do, right? Like, just give it a shot and see what happens.
Yeah.
And I think it's pretty amazing that here we are. You were talking about it and you're totally doing it.
because I think it's crucial. I mean, and I've said this numerous times, people will probably get tired of hearing me say this, but I think it's highly imperative that in the world of cancer, the young adult voice is heard. Because at the end of the day, we're in this crux of, we're not adolescent cancer. And we're not old people cancer. I mean, if that makes sense, you know what I mean.
Yeah, totally.
So you can't treat us like the kids and you can't treat us like the elders. And as we both know, and as it's been discussed previously, we have a whole set, reminds me of the movie Taken. I have a specific set of skills. Like, we have a specific set of skills, you know what I mean? We are at a specific place in our lives dealing with dating, dealing with sex, dealing with relationships, dealing with family, dealing with parents that are becoming elderly.
Oh my God.
You know what I mean? So we're Absolutely. At a completely different place that you can't treat us like one or the other. And it's so interesting. It's just interesting. But it's crucial that we're heard. It is yeah. at least that's my viewpoint.
Well, I mean, at the very least, if nothing else, I would like to hope that, right, again, we've already said multiple times, everyone's story is different, and yet mm-hmm. there's things we can all relate to.
Yeah.
But hopefully in every story, there's someone out there that just feels like, oh, good, well, yeah. I'm not the only one, yeah. right? Like,
that
I get that piece, or maybe yeah. I don't get that piece, but I get that piece. You know, yeah. I just, there is somebody else.
Yeah, there know. Is. And that's, because, I mean, let's take into consideration when I was diagnosed, I didn't know anyone. I knew one person. My mom's sister had, my aunt had breast cancer, but she's in her 60s.
Yeah. Yeah.
I knew no one that was young.
And now that you're here, isn't it amazing to think that you didn't know anyone? Because I'm like, there are so yes. many people
yes.
that are dealing with it or have dealt yep. with it or going through it. Yep. And I'm like, and I, right, it seems like you're similar. Like, I feel like I'm generally a pretty social person. I've yeah. got a large network of people.
Yeah.
I know a lot of people. Yeah. I'm like, holy crap. Like, I literally, yes, I mean, you're right. I didn't really, I mean, I knew some stories and I knew some people.
Yeah,
or a
but
couple
not
people
really
that are older.
Like,
but, like,
yeah.
I didn't really. And now I'm like, how is that possible? Because mm-hmm. there's, I mean, right?
There's so many.
So many.
But you'd people. Never know until you know.
It's
Isn't that crazy?
Crazy. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy.
It really is.
Like, so, guys, if you haven't been able to tell, you know, we're just two breast cancer survivors just kicking it. Talking about the good old days and our stories. Saying all of this to say that although Neha's and I's story are similar, Neha's now in Florida, right?
I am.
Yeah. I'm going to let her tell you what she's doing now. So what are you doing now?
I am a buyer for Bell's Outlet. I was buying prior in New York and then spent some time abroad and then came back from that, was in Pittsburgh working for a software startup and then took the time off again. And so here we are. But yes, I'm in Florida. Specifically currently living in St. Pete.
I can't wait to visit.
Please do.
Oh, remember that conference I was telling you about?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, this is so off the cuff. It's coming again in February.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, so.
Is it on your radar?
It's on my radar.
All right, keep me posted.
You're on my radar.
I love it.
Yes.
I love it.
But go ahead. I'm going to tell you that.
Yeah, no, so I that's where I am. And I don't know what any of that means yet. I mean, Pittsburgh's home, and mm-hmm. I've moved and come back multiple times, and I've thought that I'd end up in other places, and mm-hmm. Florida, I'm not gonna lie, was never really on the radar mm-hmm. or on the list. Mm-hmm. It's where I am now. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, but guys, I bring that up to say, you know, us two peeps, you know, kicking it about breast cancer and living life like it's golden, because there's life after cancer is my whole point.
Yeah,
there's life. We don't have it all figured out.
No.
You know, we definitely have every day, like her and I were discussing, you know, children and dating and like, you know, going out with so-and-so and dating such and such. And you just never know. Like you just, I mean, when do you bring up the C word? Like, oh, dog, I had cancer. Oh, darn, shucks. You're yeah. running out the door now. Okay, that's fine.
Right.
Like, it's such like.
I wonder, and I don't know, right? Like, again, like for both of us, it's relatively recent. And I'm certain that I've talked about this with a couple people that are further out. But, like, I wonder if at some point it stops being, like, at the top of the story, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, yes, they find that out about you.
Yes.
But it's not, like, totally what I'm doing, right? Even now I know that – and I know it's different for everyone. We know someone else that moved that, you know, was not necessarily talking about their cancer mm-hmm. right off the bat. And for me, I didn't go in the door going, oh, my God, I had cancer. Here I am. But I also have not been hiding it, right? It
right.
just – it's just part of my story.
It's
if it comes
there.
Up,
yeah, yeah,
it comes
yeah.
up. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But honestly, that's what I've been doing for a couple
yeah.
years. So,
but I think that's
so
a very good question. I think that's a very good question.
And so I am wondering that if, like, you know, maybe 5 years down the road or 10 years down the road, like, maybe it doesn't come up right off the bat. Or maybe you've been podcasting for 10 years straight and that's all we're talking about.
Girl,
like,
if I'm podcasting in 10 years, something's wrong.
I just, you know, I guess.
Something's wrong. I'm sorry. Let me not say that because It's not that, but I mean, I'm hoping that I've moved on to other endeavors.
Totally.
You understand
totally.
What I'm saying?
I guess I'm just saying, right? Like, yes, there is definitely life after cancer. I do think that there are things that we're all right. And maybe this goes back to what you were saying about the balance before. Are you trying to balance something else? And I feel like there is life after cancer, but it is a different balance, right? Yeah. Like moving was a whole different story, and I've moved before and always known that home is home and I can mm-hmm. come back whenever I need to.
Yeah.
And it's never been so stressful.
Mm-hmm.
And for the first time, it was hard to leave the community. It was hard to leave. And I know that I can stay in touch with people and come back and all those things. It's hard to leave my doctors, my resources, the things that you just sort of find as like comfort. And so there is for sure life after cancer, but it just, I think
it's different.
You manage different pieces, or there are different emotions or different things that you worry about.
Yeah.
But that's not to say there aren't. There's opportunities to do some really cool things. I travel a lot anyway, but even outside of personal travel, right, just coming out of treatment, there are resources out there for sure. I mean, spent time whitewater kayaking, and I spent time in Peru volunteering, and all of these things were with organization and resources out there that were supportive of those of us going through cancer.
Yeah.
Or have been through it or survived it or, you know, whatever that scenario looks like.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, and I might have to do a separate podcast on this.
Yeah.
Because I think that's a very interesting question when you talk about dating and 5-10 years from now, will that be one of the
top? Oh, what will you talk about? Yeah.
That's interesting because here's the other thing, though. Like, I guess that also ties in, and we don't have to discuss it now, of course. That to me also ties in, well, when then is cancer not your top priority? Like, when is it not your ever waking moment? Because to me, I would think those two would tie together. So if I'm 5 years, 10 years out, yes, I'm going to be different than where I am 2 years out. But in 10 years, when I'm a 10-year survivor, has life gone on so far that I completely forgot I had cancer? Well, not completely forgot, but you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Like, so then would I need to, if I'm dating at the time, of course, would I need to not bring it up first thing because it's no longer the first thing on my mind versus it being, oh yeah, and by the way,
right.
I'm a 10-year da 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 da.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It is.
You may hear that in a podcast somewhere.
It is.
I'm not jotting down anything
things
you
to,
just said.
Right? Not taking notes. I mean, things to think about. I'm curious. I'm hoping that in 10 years we're sitting here having this conversation going, remember when?
Girlfriend, hello. Because we know it could be another way. You know what I mean? We've known people who have passed away personally from what we've had, from the disease we had. So it's very interesting. It's very interesting. So, girlfriend. It was great having you on.
Oh my gosh. So good.
I have one more question for you, though.
Yes, ma'am.
It's kind of a thinking question.
Yes.
So, if you could tell your pre-cancer self something from now, what would you say?
In regards to anything?
Anything. Post-cancer self, tell your pre-cancer self something, what would it be? Advice, tidbits, nuggets you would tell yourself.
You know, maybe something that I already knew, but I think I would tell myself that, you know, to sort of trust instinct and trust your gut and like be you. Like, I don't know. Like I said, I sort of alluded to it earlier. I've made some choices off the beaten path. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know, I left my job in New York to be abroad for a year.
Mm-hmm.
In my early 30s, and people thought I was crazy. I was doing well there, and mm-hmm. you know, how could you do that? And it had been something that had been on my radar and on my list for a long time to do some of that travel and volunteering abroad. And honestly, I think that making the decisions were hard,
mm-hmm.
but going through a tough time, it was really amazing to sort of, you know, find that there was some peace in feeling like I had done these things that I wanted to do for myself.
Yeah.
And where I go with that is I would remind myself that, you know, there's a lot of pressure from the outside world or, you know,
mm-hmm.
choices to be made or how to do something, but to keep sort of going with your gut. And honestly, I, even now, like that was something that helped me then, but I almost need that reminder all over again, today as I'm trying to figure out life after cancer. So I think, you know, something about that and truly, and I mean, I would say that to me, it's all the same, but like also tying in with those relationships, right? Like, I feel like there's all these things that we think are super important in life, and they are, and we need to live and we need to figure out how to do that. But the reality is, I am super thankful for all the relationships that I have managed to keep and cultivate through my life, because through that year and a half of absolute craziness, and especially the really low moments, like, it is those people checking in and touching base with you. And right, it's a lot for any one person to deal with on their own.
Oh yeah.
And for me, and everyone's story might be different, but for me, I feel very lucky and grateful that I had all these people in my life that when one person couldn't be there, somebody else was. So anyway, I'm just saying that, I don't know, be kind, tell the people that are around you that are important to you that you love them, and just value those relationships. I mean, we all have to live our lives, but people, people and connection, at least for me, are our priority.
Sorry, I just finished my glass of wine. It's really good. I got really excited if you heard me swallowing. But yes, one thing I always talk about is my tribe. And you got to keep those people close. You have to keep the people that loved on you, let them love on you, but keep them close. Because those, especially after diagnosis, especially after treatment and all of that, because we know people that fell away. We know people that I couldn't handle it, and that's okay. You know what I mean? Because everyone can't handle cancer.
But it took time to get there, right? Oh, that's girl. Okay, peace. Like,
listen, if you read my journals, you would absolutely know. Yeah, it takes time. Yes,
it took didn't, time. It,
listen.
But you're right. But you're right. It just
this is 3 years out, child. No. No. For sure. Good advice. Good advice.
I think that's my thing.
Yeah.
What would yours be?
What I could tell my pre-cancer self, don't be so serious. Because I used to be so focused on wanting to do my dreams and visions and goals, but would get so frustrated because I wasn't accomplishing them as quickly as I wanted or how I wanted to get them done. So don't be so serious. Enjoy life, because you are young. You don't have to carry the weight of your past. Live life. Like, absolutely live. Like, if I would have told my 20-year-old self that you could move and travel and... Girl, I might not even be sitting right here doing this podcast right now. I kid you not. Like, I was such, and I've never been a homebody. I've always traveled. I've always gone on vacations and out with friends and whatever. But I've always wanted to be a world traveler.
Sure.
Girl, I would have spent my whole 20s, my whole freaking 20s, every year in a different country.
Well, here's the thing. And for some people, they travel way more. But my goal, I've got a year and a half. Yeah, but a little under that to hit. So my goal is 40 countries by 40.
Oh, awesome.
And depending on what rules you follow about, you know, things like the Vatican, does that count or not count as, as one? But regardless, if there's a couple like that, I've got about 3 to go.
Awesome.
So here's the thing. I mean, I'm traveling solo, so.
I was going to say.
Guys, where are we going?
We may just be recording this podcast in another country. So
where are we going?
Keep an eye out for that. Well, I already told you I'm going with you to India.
Oh, right. Done.
So her mom is the cutest little, just cute as a button. I was being honored at, what was it called? Oh, that's so horrible. Lanterns of Hope.
Yes, ma'am.
There's an organization here. I think I talked to you guys about it, about my crazy, amazing weekend I had, including that event. And Neha and her mom were there. She's just so cute. But your mom and dad are from India?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. And I said India. I said, Neha, do you ever like go home and go to India? She was like, yeah. I was like, I'm going.
Come on over. And I was saying that I was at the event in the event for the same reasons the year prior. And so we were there to, you know, just be a part of it again this year, which was amazing. And my mom, right, Yolanda, was there with a lot of family. Mm-hmm. And we were just sort of laughing and chatting, and we're like, my mom's like, oh my God, literally, like, right. Like, it feels like our family because there's so many of us and we're together and it's loud and crazy and nuts and you know, whatnot. So
and I fit right
totally,
in.
Totally. It'd be great.
Guys, I might be recording from India. You just never know. I'm packing up all the equipment.
I mean, I have listened to some previous podcasts. So the meat thing might be hard, but outside of that,
darn,
you're shucks. In.
Okay.
Done.
Okay. No problem. It's okay. It's okay.
As long as, you know, we can work that out, then we're good to go.
So this might be the Yolanda and Neha show soon, because we're going to be traveling these countries, guys. You just never know. We might have, like, a Travelers series. I mean, wouldn't that be amazing?
I love it.
We're doing it.
Done.
Hashtag don't steal our idea. All right? Don't do it. But it has been amazing.
It's been awesome.
Thank you for sharing your story.
And thank you all for listening to me.
Yes.
Hopefully you're still listening.
Right. I was going to say, thank you for taking the words right out of my mouth. If you are still listening, thank you so much for rocking with your girl. I hope something that we've said, like, gave you some information, maybe gave Absolutely. You some hope. I hope we dropped some nuggets you could possibly, you know, take advantage of. And if you know of anyone, I mean, her and I both had breast cancer, but anything that you go through that's difficult, some of this stuff can relate to, you know, going through other diseases or difficult times in your life. Sure. You know what I mean? So it's not just about breast cancer, guys. It's not. It's about surviving. It's about hope.
And I'm guessing that Yolanda has talked about this or will be, but like, mm-hmm. I don't know. I guess I just wanted to also throw out there for whatever it might be. I mean, I think if I've learned anything over the last couple of years, mm-hmm. there really are so many amazing resources out there.
Oh, for sure.
And sometimes when you're in the middle of it all, it's really hard to dig and find them.
Yeah.
But hopefully you can reach out to other people that can help lead you in the right place.
Absolutely.
Because there are so many things happening out there to help.
There really are. And if Neha gives me any, guys, I'll plug them in the show notes below.
Oh, yeah. I got a handful. Yeah. So if you'd like to do that,
for sure. Send them to me. Because one thing we both know, because we're connected to different organizations, is that there are other people like us. You know what I mean? Like, there's so many resources.
And we'll every plug time you think you know them, there's something else.
There's even more.
For sure.
Exactly. Remind me, I have to talk to you about someone.
Yes.
Just say that to me. Okay. But anyway, guys, again, sorry, we're rambling as always.
We might be talking about you.
But again, if you've stuck around until the end, thank you so much. I really, really appreciate it. If you want to hit up Neha, you want to plug anything?
Sure. Find me. It's Neha Kachari. Do you want me to spell that?
Please.
And like Nancy or Neha, E-H-A, last name's Kachari, K-O-T-H-A-R-I. That's on Facebook. If you want to find me on Instagram, it's mfac13. That's M like Mary, F-A-C-1-3. Or find me through Yolanda. Either way.
Or that.
But yes. Yeah. Cool. Please reach out with any.
I was going to say, because some people might have questions, concerns, what have you. But guys, thank you again so much. I will check you guys on the next one. Have a good holiday and happy new year.